Hello, and welcome to another episode of Stepping Up, where we explore the world of innovation, creativity, and advocacy to aspire to greater and new things. I'm your host, Daniel Dubois. This week, we focus on the creative industries and how one governmental organization is stepping up to ensure that their mandate is fulfilled for 2020, and how the dream of one entrepreneur snowballed into creating a platform for more entrepreneurs to get access to support, training, and resources. For Link Up, we head to Martinique to chat with our Consul General. In this episode, we head to the Cultural and Entertainment Headquarters at Barnon Hill to chat with Ms. Jeannia Frederick, Director of Events at the Cultural Development Foundation. CDF is embarking on an exciting journey of discovery and innovation around the National Arts Festival dubbed ArtReach Virtual. In light of the health protocols posed by the COVID-19 pandemic, the CDF found innovative ways of presenting the arts and culture to its diverse audience. Let's start the show as Jeannia Frederick tells us more. Today, we chat with Director of Events, Ms. Jeannia Frederick, and I am very excited for this interview because Ms. Frederick is very dear to my heart. I know in a personal capacity, she basically trained me theatrically for almost all my life, so I'm really, I would say, humbled to be having to chat with her in this capacity. Jeannia Frederick, hello, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. Thank you, Daniel. Thank you for having me here today, and thank you for having me come to talk about CDF's programs.
We wanted to talk to CDF because I know you guys have an exciting program rolling out very soon. And I think it's important, especially because Stepping Up, we focus on what agencies, governmental agencies are doing despite the pandemic to still continue to work and push their mandate. So let us know what you guys are working on.
Well, CDF's strategy is really about outreach and reaching out to solutions and the solution community with bringing artistic content and our heritage to life and having persons focus on that and appreciate that. Since social distancing, the advent of that COVID-19, we have fast-tracked a program that we had in the pipeline for a long time. It's almost like we've hit the reset button. And it's the development, it's also to help develop the cultural sector and move along this new digital wave and to help and guide artists into a model of doing something that is different and putting out different sorts of programs on television in terms of streaming and showing that we can, in a way, develop and build what we call this creative industries and orange economy and really tag on to what young people are interested in now. CDF wants to really reach out and show that it is an organization where we encourage innovation and creativity. And because of this, we've taken up the challenge of COVID-19 and rode the waves, so to speak. And what we want to do is to bring together the elements of what has happened in terms of live events. And how do you transpose that into a virtual experience that St. Lucians can appreciate, love, and let CDF be the trendsetter, the trailblazer in terms of other persons developing more programs like this that speak to our needs, our identity, the celebration of our culture, and things that are of a high quality and high standard. And by now, you must be wondering, what is she talking about? And CDF will do a formal launch where we'll present ArtReach Virtual, which is our ArtReach program, our National Arts Festival, which would have happened, you know, around April. We would have had a theater night. Yes. We would have had Sounds of the Castries Underground with poetry at Cadet Street. So what we have done, we've taken those events and we've created a new medium, a sort of a new medium for allowing the public to experience it. And we will start off with the poetry show, which will be six poets that will be featuring St. Lucian poets. Of course, it will be pre-recorded and filmed. And
have you started recording that already?
We will start next week. Okay. So you might see us around the city of Castries. I'm wondering, what is CDF doing? And that is what we're about. And we want to highlight and feature areas in Castries as well. And it will be hosted by two young persons who we think are interested in that, and people will tag on to. I think I can call their names: Tracy George Pilgrim and Hanson Narcisse, who's a teacher at Castries Comprehensive. And they're both involved in the arts in some way or form or fashion. And we're looking forward to that. And we have the big one and a big experiment. Of course, we would have put on two theatrical productions, and I think the public has known CDF for, in terms of the quality it has produced since Cari Festa.
Yes.
And it's with the way that it embraced young persons this year for Cari Festa, especially for our young writers Monique O'Geese and Jesse Myers.
Yes.
And a young cast going to Cari Festa with all new persons, choreography, and of course our impact in Trinidad and Tobago as being one of the contenders and a must-see. We got standing ovations at Queen's Hall and to a full house of persons from around the region. So a CDF is known for that. So why not take that product and bring it virtually? So what we've constructed is a sort of reality television show highlighting the theater. Most times when we watch a theatrical production, we don't understand the workings of what goes on. So this is a rare and bare and raw view of what goes on behind the scenes, the stories from the director's perspective, the stories from the actor's perspective, the conflict, how the conflict is resolved, the discipline and sticking with it, and the discipline of the arts itself, the discipline of understanding this is a job that you have to do, and coming together. And of course, so it's almost like, I don't know if to call it three-dimensional, so you have this scenario going on stage with the actors and so on, and this whole process is being filmed and the whole drama behind it. Let's just say who comes late and the director is upset for half the rehearsal, then how is that conflict resolved? I think it's something St. Lucians will enjoy and understand the inner workings of that. And our last thing is a CDF feature which will highlight the work of CDF for the past maybe 10 or 15 years, where people now understand what CDF is about, what we're doing, and what some of the things that we have done.
So it's almost like a documentary.
Yes.
Okay.
Some of the things that we have done in terms of preserving culture, innovation, and sort of jump-starting this whole industry. And CDF wants the public to know that, and we want people to understand that and know that this is a place where artists can come, and we encourage creativity, training, workshops in terms of all towards the advancement of the craft and towards the advancement of this new era that we're on, where we're trying to define what is our creative industries.
Mm-hmm. Do you think with the advent of the pandemic that you're afraid for theater? Because, you know, especially you, one of those persons who used to drill in, that, you know, the process is not complete if it's not done in front of an audience. You know, so, you know, we're losing that, but then there's still so much more to gain, especially as you're documenting the entire process. Is it still theater? And, you know, in your opinion, what's the objective? And what will be the major takeaway?
It is still theater, because this time, instead of a control group of, let's say, 8,000 people who can sit there and live in the moment, now you have millions of people in the diaspora all over the world who can relive that moment. And I say that simply because I'm sure most people, of course, went on to Netflix again.
Yeah.
And you saw Hamilton on Broadway. And finally, millions of people can see that it has now entered your living room. And that is the effect that we want. And we also want to create a balance with what is live and how many persons we can reach. And we see this as an opportunity of reaching people on a wider scale. Maybe you could not come to the production, but now it's now in your living room where you can enjoy it, and you can be part of the process, and as I say, have that moment of catharsis.
Yes, and I think it's a unique opportunity to finally, as you say, capture the process, but now not only capture, but now we can aspire. Now we can say that we could present our work on an international scale. You never know what's preventing us from being on Netflix. Why can't we? And, you know, it starts now with, you know, initiatives like what CDF is doing. So let us know a little bit. I'm sure you have plans for that because, you know, we always want to reach the international level and standard.
Well, in terms of international level and standard, CDF is really pulling out all the stops. And we have a couple of filmmakers working along with us, Kendall John, who has produced a full documentary and has filled the theater with persons. We have a couple of young directors. Well, of course, Ms. Dubois, you're one of the directors. And Hayden Ford, who has been a sort of stalwart in theater for a long time. Someone I'd call that swims against the tide. Yes. And it's exciting to see him make that transition and be excited about putting something on stage and then making that transition into film and how we connect the dots and how we work this out. It's a very exciting period. And working with the camera crew, working with production assistants, working with persons with makeup, where CDF is really trying to engineer the process, script writers, screenplay writers, and all of these are things within our pipeline in terms of training that we want to push forward so that in terms of this actual film industry, CDF is really looking towards our contribution and helping it develop and grow.
By being able to do that.
By being able to do that.
Let's talk a little bit about the buy-in. What is it that you guys have planned to ensure that you have the buy-in and the persons, the players, they take ownership behind the process? And also, how would you basically promote on the national level in terms of letting them buy into the process? And I guess you could probably give us some timelines in terms of when the nation can basically look out for the productions coming out from CDF.
Well, we have developed a massive and strategic focus promotion and marketing plan. And as we speak, we are going through the process. CDF has now brought in sort of a younger eyes into the process. We have a young lady working with us, Temba Kade, who's really into social media. And that was an education for me. You know, in terms of social media, who are the influencers? What do people watch? If you're in a certain age range, you're not on a particular social media. That's for older persons. And it's understanding that science in terms of that and in terms of our output in terms of television and really getting people to listen for a particular period of time. Maybe it's one night or during the day. This is what we're offering. Let's log on to that. And in terms of our promotion, we've really embraced this new dawn, this new era, and we're moving in that direction.
Nice. So any final words, anything you want to say, just to wrap up, because you know, Outreach Virtual, it's like it's nothing that has ever been done before in St. Lucia. And we must commend you guys for stepping up because, you know, COVID-19 has really put a stop and, you know, mass breaks for a lot of us in different agencies. So we want to say thank you guys so much.
In terms of our programming, after the CDF feature has aired, people will understand, whoa, I didn't really understand that it was CDF that initiated this process and created that, and then you will get an insight. CDF is almost like a silent giant.
Yes, basically. And I think, honestly, I'm excited for the project as well because people just don't know what happens behind the scenes.
They don't understand.
They don't know, they don't understand. So I guess capturing it in its most sincere and in these candid moments will obviously you'll educate and people will learn to appreciate. And, you know,
and to understand that it is what we're trying to get people to understand at the end of the day, the message is whatever you do, it's the discipline of continuing with it and perfecting your craft and moving beyond that, innovating, changing with the tide, changing and improving on it and appreciating what's yours. You do not destroy the root of what is yours. You do not destroy the root of flowers. You take from it and you build and you create. I mean, who would have thought that we'd be watching a Broadway play with hip-hop? You understand what I'm saying? And it is that level of creativity and innovation that we're trying to encourage by doing this project and doing what we do as an organization that promotes artistic development and training. And of course, CDF will be virtual for this period in terms with respects to our Lawas Festival. We're also doing a sort of a presentation where the documents going out into the communities and persons seeing live what happens within the setup of a Lawas Festival, their sales, their story, their history. So we're also doing that, and our emancipation program where we're doing a sort of a debate that addresses issues now, something that is relevant and current. And just organizing those things, those points, key points that really highlight who we are as a people, how we can move from one point to the next, how we can perfect things and achieve that quality. We always know that St. Lucia is just filled with talent. It is now time to harness that talent and revitalize ourselves and move in a positive direction.
Junior Frederick, thank you so much for chatting with us today. I wish CDF, I wish you fortune and favors moving forward, and all the best for the virtual outreach.
Thank you.
Coronavirus? I am worried, Gasser. It's only old people dying from that.
Hold up. Being young does not mean being safe. Yes, it's true that the elderly are at higher risk, but anyone can get the virus. The effect is even worse if you have a chronic condition like hypertension, heart disease, lung disease, and diabetes, or weakness in your immune system. If you are living with these conditions, be extra careful. Wash your hands with soap and water. Use hand sanitizer with at least 60% alcohol when hand washing is not possible. Avoid touching your face. Take steps to boost your immunity through proper nutrition, exercise, rest, and take your medication as prescribed. Limit being around people who have flu symptoms, even close family members. Our health is in our hands. Together, through simple actions, we can stop the spread of coronavirus. This message was brought to you by the Bureau of Health Education of the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
Welcome back. I cannot wait to see how Outreach Virtual 2020 pans out. We cannot deny that this is a big jump away from traditional means of theater and performance in St. Lucia. I think it would be remiss of me if I don't say kudos to you, CDF, and thank you for stepping up. The next interview focuses on women, entrepreneurship, innovation, big ideas, and the small business community. Michelle Samuel founded Slow the Terror, a platform of programs, initiatives, communities that source, connect, and empower youth, the unemployed, and entrepreneurs. Michelle was on a mission to let these individuals know that they were not alone. With the advent of COVID-19, she talks to us about her programming, which asks everyone, anyone, what is the problem that needs to be solved with this ongoing pandemic? Let's see what more she has to say. SLUDTERA, and it is a platform where she brings information and access and resources, anything that any entrepreneur may need to be able to launch their own business. And I'm here with the lady of the hour, Michelle Samuel. Hello, Michelle. How are you?
Hi, Daniel. I'm good, thanks. What an introduction. My goodness.
Well, I tried, you know, but it was so hard trying to encapsulate an introduction for you because, let me tell you, the CV long. The accolades were plentiful. And all I can say is, you know, somebody saw that the people have referenced you as being an inspirational entrepreneur. So let's talk about that and let's talk about your organization.
Okay, great. Well, the term inspirational entrepreneur does definitely resonate with me. And I say that because it is very synonymous with spiritual and holistic. Mm-hmm. And that is what that is the approach I use with almost everything that I do.
Yes.
So mm-hmm. Everything has prayer behind it, prayer before it, and prayer with it. Mm-hmm. So there is no venture that I enter to without praying about it first, yeah, and knowing that by the grace of God, it would be successful.
And I must commend you. I don't know if commending is a word to put it as, but quite often you don't find persons who are bold and courageous enough to talk about their spirituality and being able to blend, you know, your spirituality and ensure that it's a part of every single thing that you do. I mean, from exploring the websites to your CV, you did reference your Lord and Savior. And I think it's testimony to the fact that we could be anything that we want to be, and you have to always try to be authentic and stay true to yourself. So if commendable is the word, I want to say thank you. And I want to say, how has that continued to, what about you being, I guess, Christian, and you being a business owner and an operator and encourage others, what's the important message that you want to bring out and bring across?
Well, there's one basic thing that I live by. I think I can call it a motto. It's, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So when I do come across persons who are looking for assistance, who are really unsure, you know, they're filled with uncertainty as to the direction they need to go, what they need to do, and if entrepreneurship is even something they should consider, then I would ask them to look within themselves, you know, because you cannot give what you don't have. So if you have it within you to be a creator, an inventor of things that, you know, other people can utilize, if you have the skills and the talents to provide a service that other people would actually need or have a need for, then you're already in the market. You just need to find your place in it.
Yes. And as you say that, I remember we were chatting before we started the interview. You have at least 4 opportunities right now.
That's
that
correct.
You can speak about that is inviting persons to innovate and to create, especially during this ongoing COVID pandemic. So let's hear a little bit about them.
I love the way you kind of vetted us directly into the issue at hand, which is COVID-19. This pandemic really hit us at a time where we were at our peak. I mean, we were celebrating so many accolades, especially in the tourism industry. And then because of that, ironically enough, it hit us extremely hard. So now we were faced with a situation where we had to find what is it that we can do to recover, and what is it that we can do to sort of stay afloat in this pandemic time. And what happened was that several young businesses reached out to me saying, what can we do? And how can we find help for ourselves? Because at this point in time, we are the ones that are suffering the most, right? Because there's no real assistance for us. We've already had to struggle so so hard.
You're talking about small business,
the small business owners and entrepreneurs. I mean, so far they've had to struggle for what they have and where they've gotten to, but now it's extremely difficult. But I started to look and say to myself, to me, you're asking the wrong question. It's not what can be done for me, it's what I can do in this time. Because we have a certain skill, we have a certain intuitive mind where we solve problems. So that is where I came up with the theme of awaken the entrepreneur in you. And so with the 4 programs that are currently running, it definitely encapsulates, I'm borrowing your word, it definitely encapsulates this particular theme. So we start out with the Entrepreneurship Readiness Program, and that is a program that provides courses, workshops, and other developmental avenues for persons to educate themselves in terms of knowledge base. I mean, right now you have a lot of time on your hands. What are you occupying yourself doing? So now you have an opportunity to educate yourself on various things that you probably didn't think of before, or maybe you've put on the back burner. Now's the time to go into it. Whether it is a certificate in a particular area, whether it is a degree in a particular area, right now online courses are readily available. So find the thing that you put on the back burner and put it to the forefront and see how you can further yourself. And so right now we have several courses running through the Entrepreneurship Readiness Program, and one of which right now is called the Dream to Reality Professional Business Training Course. And though it is geared towards women, and I dare say that women right now are the nurturers naturally, so because of that, I felt that they were the best niche market to target, because they are the ones who look for the solutions to the problem quicker than the men do. No offense to the men out there. So this particular course is geared towards them reevaluating what's going on right now, if they are already in business, they are now be able to reposition themselves in the current market and see what they can do within their businesses to find solutions to those problems. And if it is that they're not in business right now, they now have the power to say, maybe I can do something that can provide a solution to our current problems. So we're now looking at empowering these women to create change within that realm. And through these two programs, they're now being introduced to public speaking and voicing their opinion on how they can actually solve various problems. And so after they have gone through the Dream to Reality program, they would now be presenting to the community, the entrepreneurial community, what it is that their business is about, what it is that their venture is about, and getting feedback from the community as to how they perceive it. Can this project really work?
So this is more like to prepare you or to get you to really evaluate where you are right now and to get the answers and the support that you need to be able to put a foot out and say, okay, this is what I'm going for, because of everything that's taking place.
Right. And also, it allows persons within the community to get to know who is doing something or what these individuals are doing. And since there is somebody who's trying to do something, how can I help this person get to where they need to be? Whether it is by connecting them with resources or persons that can help them get things moving on the ground a lot quicker, or if it is that they're looking for funding to really launch the project, how can I refer this person to someone that can provide them the resources that they need? And then it moves into the entrepreneurship readiness, then it moves into the Entrepreneurship World Cup, St. Lucia. Now, this particular one in itself is not something that came out of St. Lucia. My organization was invited to come on board to host the national leg of this competition, which came about as of last year. So the Entrepreneurship World Cup is basically called the biggest pitch competition in the world to date. And it's called that because there's so much to gain from it, not just on the financial scale, but also on the knowledge scale and the mentorship. And that in itself put together is an immense hybrid that can move mountains for people who are looking for the next step. So with the national leg of the competition, we're able to provide persons in all industries who've never had a platform before to put themselves out there, not just on a national scale, but a global stage. Mm. And that has never been available before. I mean, the competition which came closest to it was Get in the Ring. Now we're looking at covering across of all industries and all ages. That has never existed before.
So when are you to see that being launched in St. Lucia, and has COVID-19 delayed your plans for any of your programming?
That's an excellent question, Danielle. And as a matter of fact, what happened was that those plans, when those programs started running, especially during this time, we were faced with the fact that we can no longer connect directly with the persons that we're trying to help. Mm-hmm. How do we still reach them? And so we went strictly online. We went virtual. So with Startup Huddle, we have the events virtually, and persons watch, they attend, they basically engage with the presenters and the remaining audience, and of course our expert panel. We're able to engage virtually via Zoom. With the Entrepreneurship Readiness Program, the courses are done online. We use Canvas as the platform for our programs. And with Dream to Reality, those classes are also done virtually via Zoom, and of course with utilizing Canvas.
My next question is there a cost to access your programming?
There is no cost per se. What I like to tell people is that I look for challenges. What things that come extremely easy, you tend to lose interest after a while. I tend to look for persons who think that there's nothing that they can do. I will accept that challenge and show you that there is something that you can do. And then for those people who literally want the help to push themselves forward, I will gladly, speak with you and see what can the organization do for you through whatever program or initiative that's happening that can help you go to that next step. Now, Entrepreneurship World Cup St. Lucia, I think, is the biggest opportunity available. We were able to get Invest St. Lucia on board with us as national co-organizers.
Yeah.
And because of that, it really helped persons to see how big of a deal this is.
Yeah.
Because Investing in Lucia will never back something that is totally legitimate.
Yeah.
And we're looking at access to over $1 million in funding that persons have access to through this competition.
Two more questions before we wrap up. What is the importance? And we know that you have your organization which runs solely to support other people who might want to be interested in entrepreneurship and small business. What is the message? What is the message that you have for anybody? Why should we help each other? And I think what we might miss, I mean, it's all amazing what you're doing, but the root of it is the fact that you're helping and you're this little niche or this little gap between that you're filling between government and the banks and, you know, and access to resources. You provide that support and that cushion. Why?
The why has to do with why not?
Yeah.
I mean, we each were created with something special that we can contribute.
Mm-hmm.
We each have something that we can say, I can help do this.
Yeah.
The decision has to be, I am willing to.
Okay.
There must be that willingness to do something.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a program which I participated in 2017. It's called the Young Leaders of the Americas Initiative.
Mm-hmm.
Now, before this program, I was very, very, very soft-spoken.
Mm-hmm.
I was an introvert. You could not see me on a camera. You could not see me in front of a room.
Yeah.
However, the participation and this fellowship opened me to so many opportunities that were available, and I was just too afraid to reach out.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that that is probably the fear that exists in a lot of people. They're afraid.
Mm-hmm.
They're so used to that little box that they're accustomed to, what society has built for them, that they're afraid of what their voice may invoke.
Mm-hmm.
They're afraid of what they may be able to accomplish, and especially if they've never been told that you can do this.
Yeah.
Right? So through these initiatives and programs that SLED Terra provides access to, and of course through my dedicated team, I mean, I cannot do it alone.
Yeah.
I have an amazing team of, again, women in the organization. And so through our efforts, and they're all doing this voluntarily, we don't get paid for what we do. And that's the thing that I cannot speak enough of. We've been doing this since 2017, and we've been doing it voluntarily.
And doing it well.
And
shining.
Let the results speak for itself.
Yes.
We don't toot our horns. That's not what we're about.
Yes.
What we're about is letting persons know that if you are willing to create change, we can show you how to make the change. Just make that step forward.
Mm-hmm.
Reach out to us and see which of our programs can fit you and see how you can contribute to the community and by extension the economy.
Michelle, thank you so much for joining us today. You said reach out to us, so if you could just take 2 minutes, 30 seconds to just let us know how we can reach out to you. Let me tell you, my technician is reflexive, you know. Let us know how we can contact you.
So persons can reach out to SLED Terra via email. That is SLUDTERA@gmail.com. Again, SLUDTERA@gmail.com. That is the email. We're on Facebook as well, SLED Terra. And persons can also reach out to me via phone. I can be reached on 484-5374. Again, 484-5374. And the website, of course, is sledterra.wordpress.com. You can actually find several opportunities there readily available to you. All you have to do is click and search, and you can find them.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Fortune and favors moving forward. And all the best.
And I just want to say one more thing.
Mm-hmm.
Awaken the entrepreneur in you amid COVID-19. There is an entrepreneur in all of you.
It's a wrap. We'll be right back.
It is possible for infected food handlers or workers to introduce the COVID-19 virus into food or onto surfaces within the food business by coughing and sneezing or through hand contact unless they strictly follow good personal hygiene practices. Food handlers must wash their hands before starting work, before handling cooked or ready-to-eat food, after handling or preparing raw food, after handling waste, after cleaning duties, after using the toilet, after blowing their nose or sneezing or coughing, after eating or drinking, and after handling money. More than ever before, your important role as gatekeepers of St. Lucia's nutritional health and food security should be taken seriously. When you exercise these precautions, you not only safeguard your health, but also continue to allow St. Lucians access to clean, healthy, and safe food. Remember, it is our responsibility to ensure our nation eats fresh, St. Lucia's best.
Now it's time for Link Up. We head over to Martinique to chat with Consul General Joanna Sultan, whose reach and support to St. Lucian extends to Guadeloupe and French Guiana. Joanna, how are you and how is Martinique today?
Hi, Danielle. I'm fine. Actually, we have fantastic weather in Martinique today after such bad weather yesterday. And I understand we have a few waves heading our way. So I'm just keeping my fingers crossed that it's safe for both us here in Martinique and St. Lucia.
Wow, I know the weather is a kind of a way these days, very sporadic. And with that, we know COVID is sporadic the same way and is shooting us in so many different ways. So for Link Up, we like to always just reach out, and we have been reaching out to different ambassadors throughout the region and the world, because, you know, we have a far reach. And just finding out, what has your office been doing? How is life post-COVID?
I have to admit, and I'm sure it's the same for most of the missions, life post-COVID is definitely a lot different to life pre-COVID. So we opened up pretty early. We opened up on the 13th of May, which is relatively early compared to the other missions. But I mean, France had given us the okay to go ahead, and I wanted to really get back into the workflow. So we opened up, and of course, we had to change all of our protocols. So I mean, people coming in to visit us, they have to wear masks, practice the social distancing, no more than 4 people allowed in the office, etc., etc., etc. And that was a big change, yes. And what has been happening is that the borders to St. Lucians here, they are still closed. Even though St. Lucia has opened her borders, France has closed her borders. And of course, Martinique being a part of France, because Martinique is considered, even if it's in the Caribbean, is considered European. So what applies to France applies to her dependents. So there is a list which has the countries that are allowed, where the citizens are allowed to enter the French territories freely. And of course, St. Lucia is not on that list. So for any St. Lucia to come up, special permission is required, etc., etc. So what we've done, because we had so many requests, I mean, we have to understand that there are a lot of people in St. Lucia who come up mainly for medical reasons, and we had a lot of these requests. So what we had to do was to come up with a solution, because, I mean, we can't let our people fall sick and die in St. Lucia. We spoke to Prefecture, and currently we have a boat called the Albatross that comes down twice a week, and what it does is that it brings our sick people up. In fact, only persons with medical appointments are allowed onto the French territory at this moment from St. Lucia. So,
and how long has that been existing? Was it something, did it stop for a while, or, you know?
Well, the people have always been coming up here, but I mean, now with the borders closed since post-COVID, no one really can come up. So we, like I said, we discussed with the authorities, and so the boat has been operating for, I think, a little over 2 months, sir. And we have brought many people up, many people down. Don't forget also St. Lucians who had to be repatriated. There is actually no transport between Martinique and St. Lucia right now. Air Antilles is not flying. Express Azil is not sailing. There is absolutely no transport except for this little boat and, of course, private charters. But, you know, the private charters are very expensive and not everyone can afford them. So this little boat has been really chugging for us, working subsistently.
Is that a St. Lucian operated boat?
It's actually a French operated boat. It actually only holds 12 persons. So you could imagine the waiting list that we have. And like I was telling somebody, we have practically become a travel agency. We are getting calls like crazy because it's the only link now from the French territories to St. Lucia. People are trying now to get into St. Lucia from Europe that way. So we have people coming as far as Germany, into St. Lucia. So we have Germany, France. Well, now British Airways is flying into St. Lucia, but we have people from England, people coming as far as Guadeloupe, those who have to travel. Before we had those private charters, it was just this little boat. So we have been doing quite a bit of work. I have to admit, it is tiring, I see what travel agents and travel agents go through. It's not an easy job at all.
And I could imagine that you continue to use your discretion, because I'm sure that people have been able to move between the islands for other reasons and, you know, your role. So my next question is, what are some of the requests that you've been getting? I know that it's more about just being able to move, but I'm sure people have other reasons to move, which are as important with health concerns, etc.
Yeah, well, we do have other requests. There are people who want to see their families. I mean, you have husbands whose wives are here. They live here. They need to come up. But, of course, maybe the documentation hasn't been processed as yet. So you have people who have probably gotten married on the territory, but they don't really have the French papers as yet. They still have their Saint-Lucian passports. And so they can't come up to see their husbands. The wives can't come to see the husbands. Husbands cannot come up to see their wives. Kids need to see their families as well. So we do get those requests. But, like I said, it's really just medical urgency, medical requests that we're dealing with right now, as that is what is allowed presently. So in the interim, people just have to wait until the French border.
Do you have any pronouncements, or do you think that the opening of the borders for France, or I mean, well, Martinique by extension, are they discussing probably soon it will happen, nothing?
Well, I've been asking, nothing really as yet. And as you know, there is now an increase. The COVID is steadily increasing again in Europe. I mean, we've had to shut down Spain, certain parts of Australia, certain parts of Germany. So I understand France is also on the rise. So if France decides to shut down or close, quarantine its people, is definitely a no-no for us.
Yeah, this COVID thing looks like it's a long-haul situation.
Now, the inverse is that the Saint-Lucian borders are open. We are open. People can come in as long as they follow the necessary protocols. But what is happening is that if people have to leave here and go to Saint-Lucia to spend 14 days in quarantine, they tell you their vacation's done already. By the time they come to see their family, they have no more vacation. So they also cannot come down as they would like. Mm. But our role basically as well is to ensure that the protocols are followed. So if Saint-Lucia's coming up, they have to follow the protocols that France has put in place. And if people are going down to Saint-Lucia, they have to follow the protocols that are being put in place as well in Saint-Lucia. And we stress on that. We stress on that all the time. You must do your test. Once you get there, you have to quarantine in a government institution. If not, you quarantine in a hotel if you're...
I want to ask you, let's visualize life before COVID. And I know that before COVID, and, you know, just hearing, you know, people talking about you, that you ran a very dynamic office and you guys had some really exciting programs coming out. Like we did talk about the Independence Ball. So I want you to kind of tell me, you know, what the embassy probably would have looked like if COVID didn't come. Let us know what are some of the things that you've been successful at, you know, achieving. And, you know, so let's speak to that just a little bit.
Well, we had at least 4 projects in the pipeline for this year. Mm-hmm. In May, we were supposed to have an investment forum. We were planning, we were doing it in conjunction with the Chamber of Commerce here in Martinique. And everything was running to plan. So we would have invited investors. We were going to have our keynote speaker, Pinky Francis, a rep from Ministry of Commerce in St. Lucia, somebody from Invest, not from Invest in Lucia, from Export St. Lucia. And it really had the potential of being something fantastic, because like I said, Commerce was here on board and they had sent invitations to their different companies, associations, and it was really... Everybody was so excited, and I was really looking forward to it, because I think if had it taken place, Saint-Lucia would have gotten a lot more exposure where investment opportunities stood.
And more linkages.
Yeah, and linkages. That on the side, but it is going to happen, eh? I'm not forgetting that. Another project we had was the twinning of towns. We've got a request for Fort de France, the mayor of Fort de France, they want to twin with Castries. We have Cayenne in French Guiana that wants to twin with Choiseul. Believe it or not, I mean, French Guiana is so big, a when you compare it to Choiseul. So that would have been great for Choiseul in terms of exchanges. We had Ville des Abines in Guadeloupe that wanted to twin with also Castries. So we had a series of twinnings slated, as well as the renewal of existing twinnings, because there were quite a few towns in Tunisia twinned with French towns there between Martinique and Guadeloupe. And the mayors were talking to them. I have a very dynamic cultural attaché, Mrs. Lassonnier, and we were talking to these mayors. She was getting stuff organized. It would have been fantastic. I mean, last year, we twinned 10 schools, 10 institutions.
Yeah, I remember that.
And we were already reaping the rewards. We already started having exchanges. We had a group of 56 convent students here in January, and they spent some time going through.
And as you mentioned that, I just remember that, I think, was it last summer or a few summers ago, some young kids came down to do some theater exchanges, and that is quite exciting. And I must say that, you know, in the past few years, we have seen Martinique and St. Lucia doing a lot of work together. So my next question for you is, as we wrap up and try to conclude, how do you intend to step up, knowing that you have that fire and that vision for your office, and you have your objectives as well, in the ongoing COVID world?
Well, we are definitely going to do our programs. I am insisting by next year, hopefully. I mean, it's true, we have the COVID situation is a very fluid situation, but it cannot, we mustn't stop. It should not, we can't lose sight of the ball. In other words, we have to keep our eye on the ball with or without COVID. But of course, we have to do things in such a way to protect ourselves and also to mitigate the risk. So I intend to execute my projects, maybe with less people, because now with social distancing, you can't really put everyone in the same room. But I intend to do it. The French authorities here, Chamber of Commerce, and the other associations, they are still with the consulate. We work really closely together with quite a few associations. And so it is going to happen. I know in December already, I want to do my gala dinner like I did 2 years ago. I couldn't do it last year, but I intend to do it in December. And already we're getting the calls. Is it going to happen? Is it not going to happen? What is happening? Yeah. It was a great success. We raised funds for the St. Lucia Police Marine Unit, $30,000.
And you had a very successful Independence Ball last year.
So I'm keeping my fingers crossed that we can do it again. We can do it again.
Any messages? What would you like to let St. Lucians know? Here and in Martinique, let them, any messages that you want them to information that you want them to know, let them know how they can contact you, let them know, you know.
I must say, right now, I think everybody's aware of the consulate. We try to put it out there. If you need any assistance, call your consulate. Whether you're in Martinique, whether you're in St. Lucia, give us a call. We are here to assist. We are here to help. When it comes to medicals, I would like to put it out there that we are working very closely with Lamina Hospital. Solutions can now call us for appointments and we can put them onto. There's actually a unit at Lamina Hospital right now that Solutions can call directly for appointments. You get your quote also beforehand, so you know how much your whether it's your MRI. You know how much that's going to be. And that was, it was always there before, but I don't think that people really knew. So now, instead of, because people, that's their problem. They tell you they call Martinique, they can't get an appointment with a doctor. It's difficult. Now you can't call Lamina, the appointment will be made for you. And if you have any problems, call us. We'll direct you to them. Okay? Yeah. And we do have a Facebook page, Consulate General of St. Lucia. Everything is on that page. It's on Facebook.
Thank you so much, Joanna, for chatting with us here this morning. Well, today. Thank you very much. And I hope that, you know, I wish you fortune and favors in all your endeavors. Keep up the energy and the good spirits. And all the best and enjoy the rest of your day. What an amazing show we had this week. There are so many examples of St. Lucians stepping out of the norm and their comfort zone to help solve problems, innovate, and thrive. Keep it up. If you know anyone who's doing anything amazing in your community, please shoot me an email at steppingup758@gmail.com. Thanks again for joining me. I'm your host, Daniel Dubois. Keep safe, and until next time, don't forget to keep stepping up.